0141 951 1025. It's time to talk football. It's Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Good evening and welcome to Clyde One Super Scoreboard as we reflect on the news that Michael Beale has been sacked as manager of Rangers. 10 months in the Ibrox hot seat came to an end after a 3-1 home defeat to Aberdeen as the Rangers fans voiced their displeasure. What next then as the search begins for the next man to pick up the challenge? And elsewhere, Celtic's late winner won't have helped matters, leaving it late to go 7 points clear of their City rivals. I am Gordon Duncan. The phone lines are heating up already and waiting to take your calls. Kenny Miller and Roger Hanna.
Gordon, Michael Beale is gone. Stephen Davis is in charge. The Rangers board now have to find a new permanent manager. In the meantime, trips to Limassol and Paisley are on the horizon. Celtic are almost over the horizon in terms of this season's Premiership title. But who will be the next Ibrox boss? How quickly will the board make the appointment? And how will Michael Beale's reign be viewed by Rangers fans? We are ready to hear your thoughts on Knudsen and Muscat, Janssen and Marsh, Lampard, and maybe even Miller.
And that is the question: is who's going to be next in that hot seat? It's what will be on the minds of every Rangers fan about Scotland at this moment in time, and what's going to unfold over the coming weeks. For me, I know you need to take time and make sure the decisions are right, but I think an appointment and a permanent appointment at that needs to be in the offing pretty quickly.
01419511025, that is the number you need to get in touch and let us know what you're thinking tonight. Where did it go wrong? Was it the right decision? How do you look back on Michael Beale's reign? What type of squad does he leave behind? Who should be next? It is all there. Give us a call right now, 01419511025, or you can tweet us as well at Clyde SSB. It is extremely busy on the phone lines already, and let's remind ourselves of how we got here. This is what happened on Clyde One Super Scoreboard on Saturday.
Rangers 1, Aberdeen 3, the full-time score at Ibrox, and the Rangers supporters that are left in this ground at the moment are making their feelings known. They are not happy.
The Rangers board have to stop doing this on the cheap. They need to relieve him today of his duties, and they need to spend what they need to spend and get the right manager in.
There's never been a style of play there. The signings that have come in are absolute dross. I've sat there and watched that for the start of the season, and I still can't work out, one, what system we play, two, what game Michael Beale watches, because it can't be the same as us.
I get the frustration. Their supporters, they follow this club all the way around the world, so their support is seen. I think that they could help one or two of the players, but one or two of the players and the team have certainly got to help themselves.
There are certain criteria that you need to meet to be a Rangers manager. You need to be a winner. You need to achieve things. You know, what are we doing here? I just feel that his time is up. Get him out, Sean. It's him or me. Get him out.
And on that note, 01419511025, that is how we got to where we are tonight. Roger Hanna, how do you look back on it all?
It was inevitable. I think, you know, you sometimes know when a manager's time is up, and for the last few weeks, it's felt as if Michael Beale has been one result away from the sack. That week, he lost in Eindhoven and at home to Celtic. I thought at the time he was fortunate not to be sacked there and then. The Rangers board gave him a little bit more time to see if he could get it right. But had he lost to Betis, had he lost to Livingston, had he lost to Motherwell, he would have been gone. He did lose to Aberdeen, and I think it was just the manner of the defeat and the toxic atmosphere at Ibrox and the toxic atmosphere on the phone lines in this show on Saturday night. You knew the writing was on the wall, and it was just a matter of when rather than if.
So not, you know, the right call then for you, if that's the appropriate phrase.
I mean, it's just an inevitable call. The Rangers, there was a disconnect between Michael Beale and the Rangers support, and when that happens, there is no way back. And I think the board they recognised that yesterday.
Yes, I've got to agree. Listen, it's always disappointing seeing anybody lose their jobs, and you hope that they're going to build and they're going to achieve. But there's three things, and Rogers touched on them. The fans' reactions over a win last week was toxic after a win against Motherwell. It was a big result against Betis, but you just felt after that week that Roger said, the PSV and the Celtic defeats, that I don't even think it was a loss. I think it was dropped league points potentially away from being in trouble. You know, and it turned out that these drop points were a home defeat to Aberdeen. So it was a long way back to turn those fans around. It's 7 points behind after seven games and lost three league games, which again, the league's always the bread and butter for any old firm manager. It's been three losses in seven. And ultimately, what I think has cost them has been the recruitment. There's been a lot made of the recruitment at Rangers over the last couple of seasons. Michael was going on a huge rebuild. He was taking it on his own shoulders. He put that out there towards the end of the season that he would be the man to lead it, and he'd look these guys in the eyes to make sure they had what it took to come and face the challenge that was going to be ahead of representing Rangers. And unfortunately, at this moment in time, I would say outside of Jack Butland, there's no other real hit or positive as it stands.
George is a Rangers fan. George, sum up how it feels to be a Rangers fan at the moment.
Disgusting. It's toxic. Michael Beale took so long to come to the media room the other day because I think he was already clearing his desk for Stephen Davis to take over. It was that toxic. Even he knew it was coming himself. But all I ask him, can he not take some of the garbage he brung with him, away with him? I.e. Dessers, Lammers, even the old players like Lundstrom. Even Tavernier's past it now. It's just getting beyond a joke. But penultimately, it lands on the manager's head, as Kenny and you guys said.
I mean, it's a strong start, George. You said you're disgusted. Is that, you know, at what? At the decision to appoint Michael Beale in the first place? At the decision to give him so long? You know, what is disgusting you?
Everything. The full club is a laughing joke now. From we came back up, it's been a one thing after another. It's just constantly.
Well, look, George covers a lot of ground there, and I think we know Michael Beale won't, and I'm not saying George has been particularly serious. I think we know we can't take the players with him, and that will be the challenge for the new manager to get a tune out of them. George said, you know, Michael Beale would have known Saturday night sort of thing. Do you think he was on that wavelength as well?
Yeah, very much. Definitely. You could hear in his answers, you know, managers after games do a sort of circuit, and they'll do the radio guys, they'll do the TV guys, they'll do the Sunday newspapers and the daily newspapers. And you could tell with his answers that he knew that he'd lost the fight. You know, it wasn't even I hope the board give me more time to get this right. It wasn't I hope the board give us more time to integrate these new players. He knew. You could tell just in his answers that he was just waiting for the call from John Bennett and James Bisgrove to say he was being relieved of his duty.
Is this when you see the sort of the power of fans voicing their opinions, Kenny? The reaction after the Celtic game, what many observers said, it was like nothing they had ever heard before. Something similar after a win against Motherwell. And I don't know how Ibrox was so loud on Saturday because there was nobody left, yet it still sounded fairly lively when we, you know, crossed over at full time. So you wonder, is there just no coming back from that? You know, if you're the Rangers board, does that make your mind up for you?
It was definitely on that road after the Celtic. I actually felt it was going to be dropped league points. I don't think it needed to be a defeat, but it was a long, long way back after the reactions of fans. I mean, it got to the stage when Rangers won four games in a row there, and it was four clean sheets along that. You're starting to think, right? Okay. How many games does Michael and this team need to win in a row before people actually start to turn? And it just came to a crashing halt on Saturday. And it was the manner of it. And you can go over again because I genuinely believe Rangers should have been a couple up inside the first 10 minutes with the chance they created. But it was the manner. Like when Aberdeen scored and they took their opportunity for that corner, I just looked at the team and I thought, I don't know even if they believe they can get back into it. And I just think that's the general feeling surrounding the club at the moment. And it's definitely how the fans would have been feeling when a here we go again feeling, you know. So, and as it went 2-0, and then Scott Wright gets sent off, and then you got a lifeline, and then you concede straight away. And it was, a brilliant result for Aberdeen. You know, it's on their part of their mini revival. But for Rangers fans, I just felt after that Celtic game, even that Motherwell, when you've actually won again, It was really, really toxic. It was negative, and it was always going to be a long way back, if there was a way back, to turn them.
George, were you for Michael Beale's appointment in the first place?
No, I thought the job was way too big for Michael Beale. Honestly, guys, if I could have got behind my couch on Saturday afternoon, I would have been still hiding there than now.
I wouldn't recommend that, I must admit.
Who would you have, Josh?
No, we'll get to that. Let's look back first. We've got a lot of ground to cover. Because obviously we are now all speaking with the benefit of hindsight, and there's a little bit of honesty required here when I ask people how they felt. Now that we... Was that job too big for Michael Beale?
Yeah, I think so. It was always... Listen, any managerial appointment is a gamble. They don't all pay off, you know. And at the time Giovanni Van Bronckhorst was sacked 10 months ago, Rangers gambled in the extreme by appointing a manager who I think had 19 games in his entire managerial career. He had 9 career wins as a manager. And he's come in at a time when Rangers, when the league was effectively lost last season. And I think Rangers supporters like George would have wanted some sort of signs of improvement. Could Rangers win one of the cups? No, they couldn't. Could Rangers rebuild in the summer and get off to a flyer this season, get into the Champions League groups again, make up for last season, and present a real challenge in the Championship to Celtic? Would have done neither this season, and they look further away from Celtic now than they did a year ago when Giovanni Van Bronckhorst was leaving the club. So it was a gamble taking on such an inexperienced, a rookie manager, if you like, and it's one that's backfired.
Thanks very much to George for kicking us off tonight. You can tell George's emotions are there. What about Jim? I mean, George says he's disgusted at the way this has all happened. Jim, how would you sum up the way you feel about it?
How you doing, guys? You're just echoing what every other bear's saying at the moment. See, the decline in our side since the Scottish Cup final win over Hearts in 2 seasons is absolutely staggering. Regarding Beale, I didn't like the guy for the off. I didn't like the way he came up to the stadium 2 weeks before Gio was sacked. Then when he gave that goal back to Thistle, that finished me off with the guy. So I'm delighted he's away. It was just a guy clearly at his depth that shouldn't have been there in the first place. But regarding the bigger picture, our board simply don't know how to appoint a manager. You can actually see every ex-player that's been interviewed since Beale's been sacked almost try to guide them in the direction of appointing a serious, experienced manager. Now, I'm 48, and you can mirror back when we were in top and Celtic were second best. All we're doing now is going through our versions of Liam Brady's and Lou McCarry's until we appoint our version of Martin O'Neill that's going to come in and you're going to, that can bring you back. We're going to just keep... This is just going to keep going.
So seriously, your dislike, if you like, or your distrust of Michael Beale goes all the way back to letting Partick Thistle walk the ball in?
Well, to the big time. And even though I didn't like the way he came up before Gio was sacked and he was in the stadium and in pubs with fans, and then 2 weeks later he's got the job, I thought that was really underhand. And now he can understand the situation Gio was in. But to cut Gio some slack, at least Beale had the chance to sign his own players. I don't think Gio managed to sign any of his own players. That was all through Ross Wilson.
I did wonder if that, you know, the turning up at Ibrox under when Giovanni Van Bronckhorst was in position would come back to bite Michael Beale, and it certainly seems to, because it's one thing opposition fans having a pop at it, or neutrals and media spectators or whatever, but it seems to be something that the Rangers fans now are bringing up.
Yeah, and listen, I think it's an unwritten rule among football managers. Kenny's probably better placed to answer this than I am, but Giovanni Van Bronckhorst was under heavy pressure at that stage. Rangers were having a historically bad Champions League campaign. They were dropping points to the St Johnsons, to the Livingstons, to whoever at that stage. And to have a former Rangers head coach or former Rangers coach coming up, a man who knew he was high up in the betting to be the next Rangers manager, and for him to be appearing at Ibrox and, as Jim says, appearing in Rangers supporters' pubs around that time, probably was frowned upon by other managers and coaches and people within football, because it's not really the done thing, Gordon.
And I know there was a lot said about the Partick Thistle goal, but I didn't realise it was a reason for fans to genuinely lose faith in Michael Beale, Kenny.
No, I think that's one thing that's a little bit harsh, I'd say, but I would definitely agree with the turning up in the director's box for that game. I thought it shows a real error in judgment. And you know, there was a lot of Rangers fans at the time, I don't think we're happy with that type of kind of behaviour, considering when there's a fellow manager down there suffering at that time, you know, and he's been through it now. He's went through a real tough time, Michael himself, over this last few months. And at that time, I don't think it showed a level of class that you need to probably be that Rangers manager. But again, what I would say, with hindsight, it's easy. Mm-hmm. I do also know there was thousands and thousands of Rangers fans were on board with Michael coming to the club as a manager. And you know what? They were the same guys, same when Gio was coming in, because he ticked all the boxes with the ex-player, we're having the success, and that never worked out either. What the board have got is got a real, real tough task now to make sure this is the right call with the right man who comes in.
Jim, when a manager is in place that you see as being the wrong man, and then he's relieved of his duties, that can and should be almost an exciting time to believe that things are going to get better. It doesn't sound to me as if you're too confident about that.
No, I'm not. That's the biggest problem we've got at the moment, is what direction the ball's going to go in. As I say, you can actually see all your ex-players, Kevin Thompson, Boyd. I don't know, Ken, if you've said it yourself, that they're actually, every interview they say that the club needs an experienced manager, which is the problem at the moment, who you would take. Personally, I wish it happened 10 years later, but I'd take Neil Warnock to the end of the season.
Oh, so would I. For this show alone. I mean, my needs are not really important here. I just think about what would be box office for us. That would certainly tick that box.
Well, yeah, I don't think I would be short of a back page too often between now and the end of the season, Gordon. You wouldn't be short of any sound bites for this show. He would. Listen, he's available. He has...
Him and Hugh Keevans could hit it off, two men of a similar generation.
I think you've taken that too far.
I'd love it. Go on. Why not? On a more serious note, Kenny... That is the challenge, because we're going to hear all these buzz phrases, you know, experience or someone that knows Scottish football or someone that, whatever it is, when a managerial search comes up, there is no blueprint for it. And good luck making the decision, because the pressure is on big time.
You're right. It's, all these words will come at experience, proven track record, winner, character, personality, knows the game, knows our game inside out, knows the players, knows the teams. I think Ange disproved that. Coming for Japan, coming for Australia, never probably knew too much. Listen, everybody knew about Scottish football and who Celtic were, but it's...
I suppose he was experienced though, wasn't he? In terms of, he was an experienced manager, yeah. Michael Beale wasn't.
That's, so he ticks that box. Yeah. He ticks that box. He doesn't tick the known Scottish football box. No. He doesn't tick the anything else, but... It's not even about, there just needs to be the right guy. And I think we said it off air, whoever it is needs to come in and hit the ground running. And one of the biggest things for him and what he's going to need to do is get a tune out of the current group, a better tune out of the current group, because this is what he's got to work with for the next 3 months. Between now and the 1st of January, this is the group that he's got. Get the injuries back, get more out of this current group of players, and that is going to be the first job at hand.
Do the players need to take more responsibility than they're getting on this show so far, Jim? It can't all be Michael Beale's fault, is it?
That's a good question. I think when the chips are down, it's a really big jersey to wear, and you need to be able to handle it, and not one of them has been able to handle it since the start of the season. It's all right when things are going smoothly and it's a great jersey to wear and that, but it's, when that stadium's in Topia, it's a big shirt to wear, and not one of the players have got the character to handle it. So I think that's the problem. So there's not one of them. I mean, everybody's talking about Jack Butland, who's been an amazing signing, but the rest of them, you just wonder where he's went to get these guys. That's the problem. Who's actually scouted and then went, he's worth $4 million, or he's worth... They're a series of journeymen. There's no winner mentality anywhere in that side, including, I hate to say it, he's always done it, but Tavernier as well. It's just, we need winners to the top, for the board, right down.
Well, look, this is why, you know, managers, when they sort of put themselves out there and let everyone know that they've got more of a hands-on role in recruitment, that can be great if it goes well, but it's also a stick to beat you with. And unfortunately for Michael Beale, that's the case here. He's the one that sat all summer and said that he went and he looked these guys in the eye and I'm taking more of a role because there is no Ross Wilson, there is no sporting director, and I'm comfortable with that and I'm enjoying that. Great if it goes well. It hasn't, and therefore that's extra criticism for him. Surely he can't he doesn't have the safety blanket of people blaming someone else for the signings.
No, he doesn't have what they had the previous summer, where everybody who has signed these players, is it Giovanni, is it Ross Wilson? He doesn't have that, and he's put that out there himself towards the end of last season. He was putting in the hard yards to go and recruit players that were going to be capable to challenge for Celtic for the league this year. And at this stage, it doesn't look like that's going to be happening. And I think it was the previous caller that actually says we need to see improvements in these players. you know, you need to, and to answer Jim's question, absolutely the players need to take responsibility for when they cross the white line, for their performances, for the decisions that they make within these performances. So listen, the buck always stops with the manager, and this is managers, everybody involved in it, coaches know exactly what they're getting into, but the players absolutely need to take a responsibility.
Quite a bit of anger and frustration out there, to say the least, tonight. 01419511025, get your thoughts in, we'll speak to you next.
The voice of Scottish football. Call 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Roger Hannah and Kenny Miller are here. It has been a passionate start to the phone calls. Disgusted was the very first word we heard from a Rangers fan on the phone tonight, which might or might not echo or mirror some of your feelings, I should say. Nathan is a Rangers fan. Next up, how do you feel about Michael Beale now, Nathan?
Never liked him to begin with. I've never liked him since, you know, he came up when Gio was in charge. It was, I know it's been said previously, but it was disrespectful. Guy was under pressure. He's come up, sat in the stands, and made the guy probably feel like I'm getting booted out next week. You know what I mean? Totally disrespectful. He's just an. I don't even want to say the word because he'll get kicked off. But disgusted really with him. He's just no Rangers type, you know what I mean? Like, when he was at QPR, he was the manager for about 20 games, maybe more, maybe less, right? When he took the Rangers job, he was on a 5-game losing streak, you know what I mean? QPR were starting a downfall, and they both thought, oh, we'll bring in somebody that's lost his last 5 games. What's the thoughts behind that? When there was better targets out there, like Kevin Muscat's been thrown about now, he was a target last season, why didn't we go for him? Somebody that's won trophies, somebody that's proved that he's got the winning mentality. In Australia, won the A-League. In Japan, he's won whatever that league's called. I mean, the J-League, there you go. Mm-hmm. He's proved he's a winner, right? And he doesn't need to prove his sale anymore. He's Rangers class, he's won trophies. Michael Beale, 20 games. What did he do? Nothing. Won 8 games. QPR were already starting to fall down the table. And then with his recruitment side, I'm sorry, but a manager can say he wants this type of player and that type of player. He's not a scout. He doesn't know the basics about scouting. He can go and watch a player and think, oh, that player's doing good. I mean, he just scored a goal. We'll sign for about 4.5 million. The guy scored about 5 goals last season, Dessers. Is that really Rangers quality? Are we signing people now that will score 5 goals a season? I mean, then he's got Vidi Alfredo, Morelos, Colac, and Kent combined, they scored over 30 goals last season. Like, where's the goals coming from? There's nothing there, nothing at all. The guy's just an absolute idiot. He's an idiot.
Bit harsh. Sorry, Michael, if you're listening. Yeah. I don't know if we need to resort to personal insults, although I was worried about whatever word Nathan was going to use previously. So if that's as bad as it goes, maybe I should take it in the chin and move on. How much has Michael Beale's recruitment played a part in this?
Two things have done for Michael Beale. One, his inability to win the big games. Mm-hmm. He couldn't beat Celtic when there was something on the line. You know, cup semi-finals, important league games. I know he got the win at Ibrox after Celtic had won the title last season. But again, at the start of this season, PSV, not Celtic at home. The Celtic finished that game, remember, with a back four of, was it Ralston, Lagerby, Elk, Scales and Burnaby. And Rangers couldn't score a goal. So it was that has done him, but also at the minute, the recruitment. He could do nothing but Morelos and Kent leaving. Their contracts were up. They could do what they liked. But to get rid of Colac, 17 goals, to get rid of Sakala, who I think was a bit of a fan's favourite, to get rid of Yanis Hadji, again, if he wants to do that, great. But you need to bring in players who are an upgrade on those players. And from what we've seen of Lammers, Dessers, Seema, they are a downgrade on the players who have left. And that's not good enough for Rangers, and it's not good enough for Nathan and the Rangers support.
But see, on that though, right, so that was, Nathan covered a lot of ground there before we got to the insults. We'll go back to the bit before that. He's saying, I mean, why did we appoint him in the first place? He had only, what was the actual figure, 18 games?
I think QPR, 19.
He'd only managed X amount of games, and he'd lost his last five, or winless in his last five, so shouldn't have hired him. But really, nothing should have been based on the QPR spell, because it was so short, good or bad. The reason, and let's be honest about this, is this perception that he was, how many times have you heard the phrase, the brains behind stopping Celtic winning 10, or the brains behind Steven Gerrard, how true or not that is, that clearly played a big part, Kenny. So did we see in action the challenge of being a good coach versus being a good manager?
That's exactly what it is, because there is, you're right. Did he start okay at QPR? Yes, his team were at the top of the league then. They did lose a few games just before, like Nathan says. But it is irrelevant. The relationships that he had built whilst he was at the club for the 3.5 years under Steven Gerrard, the job that they'd done building a team to go and get 55 and stop Celtic getting 10 in a row, that's the reason behind getting the job. Listen, the difference between being that head coach or assistant and being the manager of a club, any club to be honest, but a club like Rangers where the demands and the expectations are so high, off the back what's happened last year as well, coming into this year, it was going to be extremely high. But it's, the differences are, when you're the coach, you're solely focusing on the job at hand, which is to devise the sessions, which is to deliver the sessions, which is potentially come up with that game plan with the other staff. And then that's the bubble that you live in. When you're the manager, you're by the looks at Michael's still doing all that. You're now going to have to deal with the board. You're dealing with the fans' expectations. You're dealing with the media duties. You're dealing with, as it was last year, recruitment, whereas there was no Ross Wilson there helping that out. Again, previous summer wasn't great recruitment either. So it took on so much. And that is the differences between being that coach for Steven Gerrard, where he could solely focus on what his role within that staff was.
Yeah, I'm going to try and separate you two into your areas of expertise, if either of you have got one. Kenny, that's the football bit of it. I wonder, from, you know, with your sort of journalistic hat on, Roger, or looking at the man, the character, because as Kenny says, you then need to deal with everything. How did Michael Beale handle himself, carry himself, conduct himself, express himself? How much did that stuff work or not work for him?
Listen, he spoke a lot from a journalist's point of view. He was perfectly reasonable to deal with. He never left you short of words. He never left you short of audio for this show. But at the end of the day, you know, George, Jim, Nathan, the Rangers fans have phoned the show tonight, Gordon. They're not really particularly bothered whether he's good for you or good for me. They want results on the football pitch, and that was where he came up short. He wasn't delivering the results, whether it's because, as Kenny says, he was spreading himself too thinly in all the roles he was taking on. It doesn't matter. The bottom line is, the results were poor. Three league defeats out of seven.
That's you going back to Kenny's area. I'm gonna rein you back in. Fine, but were there times then? Because again, good for us. I've seen it said on social media in the last few days. Maybe, you know, maybe said too much. Maybe contradicted himself. Maybe allowed Rangers fans to then say, "Hold on a minute. Last week you said this, or on Wednesday you said that." Yeah. And I feel like there was obviously the result is king, but I still feel like there was more than that.
He did build up a lot of players. You know, Jose Cifuentes was going to be a game changer for Rangers. I haven't seen it yet. Dujon Sterling was going to do this, that and the next thing. He's hardly been seen in the team. Dessers and Lammers were going to score however many goals and do, you know, whatever, and they were going to, you know, take Rangers to another level. And they haven't done it. So, you know, you can understand the thought process in trying to build up his players' confidence. But the players and him need to back it up with performances on the pitch, and they've just not done it, Gordon.
Thank you to Nathan. What about Ian, who's a Rangers fan? Ian, how do you feel about everything that's going on at your club at the moment?
I don't know. I feel like my head's spinning, to be honest. Because for weeks, well, since the Celtic result and performance, things have just steadily get worse, or they're certainly not getting any better. And it's been really, really strange, because I phoned up a while ago, after, in fact it was after the Celtic and Rangers game, and I think it was Andy Halliday that was on, and I'd said, look, I sat and watched the game, the Celtic and Rangers game, and I didn't know what the plan was. I didn't know where we were going, and I couldn't see any kind of directive, and the players just looked lost. And Andy, I'm sure it was Andy, said that, well, I could kind of see what he's trying to do, but I couldn't. And I don't think anybody, any Rangers fans, can, from what I've kind of picked up on. And do you know the funny, why I'm saying it's really confusing, is because Celtic done their usual. They scored in the last two late goals to win the game. And I was gutted. I was, no, again, oh, no, no, again. But, you know, after that result yesterday, I was glad Celtic won it. I was glad because if Celtic would have dropped points and then Rangers would have put in a performance for that and we could have caught up with them and maybe get back on the coattails again, it would have been worse in a funny way. The fact that we never took advantage when we had the chance, you know, it's totally confusing. And where we go from here, we can't bring in another manager who hasn't been tried and tested and doesn't know what he's doing. I was all for Michael Beale. I'm not one of these guys that's going to come on and say I didn't want him there. I did. I thought it because I believed all the hype. Maybe that was just me being naive, but I believed what you were talking about. It was the brains behind Steven Gerrard, and he was a sort of genius, and he was going to do this and do that, and I was excited. But it quickly fell away and never materialised anything at all. In fact, it's been really, really disappointing, and he's took his back the way, to be honest.
I'm glad Ian said that, because I didn't want to constantly to people saying I never liked him in the first place, because I didn't believe that to be a true representation. So I'm glad Ian said, you know, holding his hands up and saying he had high hopes, and it didn't pan out. I suppose, Roger, going back to the Celtic game, ultimately Celtic are better than Rangers and have been, and you lose 1-0, it's fairly narrow. That should be forgivable. But there was something about it that wasn't in the eyes of the Rangers fans, or was it part of this bigger picture?
I think it's been particularly painful for Rangers supporters, because at the time I think they felt Celtic's injury situation, particularly in defence, had left them vulnerable. I think Rangers fans thought this was a chance. The game was at Ibrox, it was early in the season, it was going to be a makeshift back four for Celtic. Celtic had not had the greatest of starts to the season with Brendan Rodgers coming back. They were going through a little transition of their own, and I think Rangers supporters had built themselves up to believe that this was going to be the opportunity to beat Celtic in a meaningful game for the first time under Michael Beale. And once again they fell short. Should have been ahead, weren't ahead, lost a sloppy goal, couldn't get back into the game.
You can usually divide it into, well, here we'll divide it into about 49 categories, Kenny, but if there are main ones for any manager, results, obviously top. Another one that keeps coming up is recruitment. Style of play, I'm interested in, because Ian mentions it, loads of Rangers fans mentioned it. Every week we would get calls, even after wins, saying, I don't really see this, I don't see the plan. It's not like you can see a plan and it's just maybe not quite clicking. They couldn't see it. And that's the bit that would fly in the face of this idea that, well, even if Michael Beale is lacking X, Y and Z as a football manager, he's meant to be a very good coach. So hopefully he can make players better and put a style on that people can see. How much did that hold him back?
It holds him back now. Like, see, when I go back to Walter Smith here, Alex McLeish, I don't think you would have heard these types of discussions. I just think it's new age coaching. Mm-hmm. You know, and this is it. We need to understand what it is. But by the way, It's the coaches now that are putting that out there as well. So fans jump on it. They want to see an identity, a style of play. They want to be entertained.
That doesn't make it wrong, though, does it?
No, it absolutely
doesn't.
Because
most good teams now have one.
Yeah, well, you would say so. But by the way, not all these styles are actually through design. Sometimes if you've got good players that actually go play well when you enjoy watching
it. Usually it's recognisable now, isn't it?
Well, listen, you say that. I'm not on that. I'm not on that side. I understand where coaching is now, and I want to be in it, and I've been in it. So understand what you're trying to do. You want to put an identity on your team. You want your team to also reflect you. Sometimes that can be a bad thing, by the way.
I agree with that, Kenny, and they want to put their identity on. But when coaches put their identity on a team, usually to the layman, Gordon, myself, the Connors, you can usually identify what that identity is. You know, oh, it's a 4-3-3 and they're trying to do this, or it's a 3-5-2 and they're pushing wing backs on to give them the width. I think the problem for a lot of Rangers fans is they couldn't see what Michael Beale was trying to do. They couldn't see what the formations were. And a lot of the time, the players looked confused as to what the formations were and what they were trying to do.
Listen, I would just say the players have not played well to that, because also identity, again, maybe to the layman, for me, that's a formation. It's a 4-3-3 and a 3-5-2. That's not your identity. No. You know, so... But by the way, I actually get it. I do, I get it and agree. I agree with Ian and agree with the point that what we've seen for Rangers has not been good. So if an identity, by the way, is we're performing well, then it's not there. Rangers have been taught, again, there has been a lot of injuries to key players, right? I get that. But those key players, Cantwell, Raskin, Lawrence, Roof, were already in the building. So the Simas, the Danilos, the Dessers, the Lammers, Cifuentes, they were the guys that were supposed to be brought in again. Not to take them on another level, but to make them better and improve the starting lineup. And at this moment, that's not happening.
And there's been a lot of criticism in this show, and Saturday, and previous weeks, Gordon, about Michael Beale. The criticism will get a lot worse if Stephen Davis and his group of coaches come in and suddenly get a tune out of Lammers and Dessers and Seema and Sterling and all these guys.
Well, we'll get to that, because Rangers do have an interim coaching team of Stephen Davis and Alex Ray. So if you've got thoughts on that, get them into us right now. Let me run this past you. Clyde One. It is a double rollover, make me a winner, after the last person we called said hello, which is understandable, instead of make me a winner, which is clearly the phrase that you need to remember. We could make you a winner of £94,000 tomorrow when we make another call, but you need to be in the draw and you need to say make me a winner straight away when we call you. So text yes to 61025. Texts are £2 plus your standard network rate. You can enter at clyde1.com and online entries are £2, or call 0330 880 4523 and calls are charged at a standard rate as well. It's over 18s only, and the entries since Tom won on Thursday have rolled over. So all the rules for this network competition are online, and if you get the call from us after 3pm on Tuesday the 3rd of October, answer within 5 rings, say make me a winner straight away to win £94,000. Text yes to 61025.
0141 951 1025. This is Scottish football's league leader, Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Brian is next up. The phone lines are red hot. Keep your thoughts coming in on the news that Michael Beale is no longer the Rangers manager. It happened about, what, it was 10 o'clock last night?
Oh no, half past 8.
Oh, half 8, was it? God, so the weekend gets away from me in my old age. So last night it became clear that was the road Rangers were going down, and they announced that Stephen Davis would step in an interim charge, assisted by Alex Ray. You can get your thoughts in on that, your thoughts on who should come next, all the rest of it, like Brian in Glasgow has done. Brian, what was your sort of gut reaction when you heard that news last night?
Happy. I sit in the Broomwood front and just watching the game. It's horrendous. They scored and Butland was shouting, and then you've got Tavernier, your captain. And then you've got Golson, your vice captain, what with their heads doing, not even try to G the team up. And I'm like, we're done. And then we scored. And I was like, please don't score again. Because if we score again, it's just going to paper over the cracks. And I think, genuinely, I think looking at the videos that's on Twitter and that now, Tavernier not even taking the opportunity to talk to fans and telling them there's nothing to talk about. I hope the next manager that comes in has the, without saying it, the bottle to strip to have the captaincy and give it to somebody like Butland. Because right now, I know I'm getting off a wee bit, but we'll get Butland, we'll get Tavernier, Goldson, Barisic, Jack, Roof, Wright, you know what I mean? Are all, to me, they're all serial losers.
So is your frustration aimed more, I mean, it's been one-way traffic against Michael Beale tonight, are you more angry at the players for allowing this?
Oh, 100%. Mate, look at Kenny sitting in the studio tonight, and I don't think Kenny would have played under many captains the way Tavernier is. You know what I mean? He doesn't try and G the players up. I've seen it time and time again. Keepers McGregor shouting at him and Tavernier telling him to calm down. That doesn't happen, do you know what I mean? It's just frustrating. I think I wanted Michael Beale as soon as Gio was getting announced. I would have preferred my Bill. Would I like Bill to work out? Of course I would have. But it's known, it's happened, it's done now. But I just think that the players have got to take a lot of blame, and he's got to strip. Whoever comes in now has got to strip Tavernier the captaincy and Golson, and just get rid of them and start afresh, because that's the way it's going for me.
Has he been let down by his players? There has been injuries. We said that, you know, Michael Beale would love to have played Raskin and Cantwell and possibly Lawrence and Roof and Matondo, and maybe even Danilo at the weekend. So that obviously, you know, he was hampered by that. But the ones who remained, did some of them let him down?
Well, Jack Butland said after the game against Aberdeen at the weekend that the players had to do more. The players had to knuckle down, shoulder the burden of expectation of playing for Rangers and improve performances and improve results. So no point, no need for me to say it. Jack Butland said it himself. The likes of Tavernier on Saturday, football players are human beings. The Rangers players on Saturday, as that game unfolded, would have known that in all likelihood the manager was going to be sacked. You don't want that on your CV. You don't want that in your conscience when you get up the road on Saturday night knowing that your performance has helped a man lose his job. But that's football for you, Gordon. I've a bit more sympathy for the Taverniers and the Goldsons because in their Rangers careers, you have seen good performances from some of these players. They've reached a European final, they've won a league, they've won a Scottish Cup. It's not widespread success, but it's a degree of success. I think the problems that Michael Beale's had this season are mainly down to the poor displays of the summer signings, because with the notable exception of the goalkeeper, none of the players have produced a performance of note in a Rangers jersey.
I know people don't tend to care what my opinion is on these things, Kenny, but just the journey that I've listened to on this show over James Tavernier, I'm now wondering if we have reached some sort of breaking point, just because every time this comes up, every time it goes wrong for Rangers, someone will call in and say, I don't think he should be the captain. And generally, I always think, is that really Rangers' biggest problem? Usually my answer in my own head is no. But I do wonder how many more managers this conversation is going to keep coming up. Is it worth to even remove it as a talking point that a new manager starts afresh with some of these players?
Listen, Tav is always a target when things go wrong, and he has been over his time at the club. I've not been someone who's jumped on him at all because I don't believe in it. Listen, he was handed the captaincy in a time where there probably wasn't a lot of options when Steven Gerrard came in. Tavernier had been at the club, he was a regular performer, he was always going to play every week. And by the way, that will continue when the next manager comes in as well. He will continue to play, because whether you like him or you don't like him as a player or a captain, there's far more pressing priorities than replacing the captain and the right back at this moment in time.
Yeah.
You've went through the list of injuries. I would go and say there's not one of those players where they started the game in that front areas of the pitch had everybody been fit on Saturday or in previous games for that matter. So I just think there's a lot more pressing priorities than worrying about what James Tavernier. Listen, that might be a topic for conversation a year or two's time. And when a new manager comes in, maybe he's got a really, really good right back he wants to bring in that he thinks, you know what, maybe it is the time. But for me, like I've said, there's far more pressing priorities.
How do you feel about the club as a whole just now, Brian?
It's a hard one, because I think Douglas Park, when he was there, I think it was all about him. The thing that annoyed me was this cinch deal. Oh, we're not doing this because he parts of my company, parts of Hamlin at Disney, really. And I think instead of building a relationship with the SFA, Douglas Park sabotaged it even more. So I think that now John Bennett and Bishgrove are there. They need to try and salvage that. But I think the bigger task they've got in their hands, for me, don't know if you would agree, but I think we need to install a director of football and then get the director of football to install the manager, because I don't trust Bishgrove and John Bennett to install a manager.
Well, if that's the case, then we could be in for the long haul. It could take a while.
But you've also got that case if, like, maybe there's maybe people will think maybe the sporting director or director of football might be a more important appointment. So it still needs to be the right guy. It's going to come in with the right vision and help to take the club forward. By the way, on all football in France, so whether it be performances, whether it be style or identity, whether it be recruitment, and then again, appointing, getting the right manager in to actually then go and deploy all that, there's a lot of responsibility if that's the role of the director. But what I would say is, since Ross Wilson left, I've barely heard a word about a director of football coming in at Ibrox.
It's actually a really good point, Brian, and one hopefully we can pick up on very soon, because it's that time of the night already.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
It's all very serious stuff when a manager loses his job. Maybe for 2 minutes, a bit of light relief in the form of Beat the Pundit if you fancy it. Some light-hearted competition where you could embarrass Kenny Miller or Roger Hanna by dialing 01419511025 before 7 o'clock.
tackle the headlines. 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Kenny Miller and Roger Hanna are here at 0141 951 1025. They're looking for you to share your thoughts on the day's or the weekend's biggest talking points. And there are absolutely no prizes for guessing what that is. It is the news that Michael Beale was sacked as Rangers manager last night, and the inquest into what went wrong and the thoughts on what should come next are well underway. We've actually not chucked too many names around yet. We've kind of been looking back, so maybe this is a good time to do it. Who do you want next, Rangers fans? 0141 951 1025. We'll play this first.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Okay, Beat the Pundit time. Either Roger or Kenny will play against Johnny from Lennox Town. How's it going, Johnny?
I'm fine, thanks, Gordon. Yourself?
Yeah, not too bad, Johnny. I'll tell you what, when Motherwell pegged it back in the 95th minute or whatever it was, did you imagine this weekend would take the twist that it has since then?
I was gutted, and I didn't see just in the 96th minute. You're thinking that's it, it's going to be one each. So it's been a good weekend in Lennox Town, Gordon. It's been a good weekend. Yep,
I bet it has. Not in certain other parts of Glasgow in the west. It just depends where you are, really, hasn't it? Heads,
it
would be
more in here. I thought I was listening to the game from Kilmarnock, and I could just visualise the Mushroom celebrating 87 minutes. Lewis Palmer scores. You and the Dazzler going mad when Blair Spittle equalised, and then the Mushroom having the last laugh.
I maybe threw a few too many arms around at the equaliser, which obviously came back to haunt me.
Shapes, Gordon.
Anyway, we move on. Heads, it's Roger. Tails, it's Kenny. On Beat the Pundit, it is heads, Roger Hanna. He's so good, he starts on minus one, Johnny. Can you take him down?
Cheers, Johnny. Good luck.
Cheers, Roger. I think I'll lead it.
Right, anyway, let's give Roger some greatest hits radio to listen to. 30 seconds on the clock. And your time, Johnny, starts now. Name either scorer for Rangers in the Scottish Cup final in 2022.
Morelos.
Which team's the only Scottish Premiership side without a win this season?
St Johnstone.
Duncan Ferguson managed what club before Inverness?
Assistant at Fleetwood Town. Fleetwood.
What round of the Scottish Cup gets played at the end of the month?
The second round.
Name any of the Scottish clubs Alex Ray's managed.
He's been sacked for them all, hasn't he? Millwall.
Let's bring back Roger Hanna. Roger, can you hear us?
Well, just enjoying Melinda Carlisle there.
Very good. Same set of questions, shall we?
Go.
Go. Name either scorer for Rangers in the 2022 Scottish Cup final.
Ryan Jack.
Who's the only team in the Scottish Premiership without a win this season?
Johnson.
Duncan Ferguson managed which team before Inverness?
Forest Green Rovers.
What round of the Scottish Cup gets played at the end of this month?
The second.
Name any of the Scottish clubs Alex Ray has managed.
St Mirren.
The Accidental Footballer is the autobiography of what former
Pat Nevin.
Which SPFL club have scored the most goals this season?
Oh goodness. Falkirk.
Didn't need to ask you how you think that went, Johnny.
Not so good.
not so good, says Johnny. And you know, when Roger Hanna's in town, it tends to be quite difficult. It's getting pretty. I think you are staring at minus two. Honestly,
no chance.
I think we should at least trial it.
No, we trialed it before.
I know that was the worst thing, though. We did trial it one night and they lost just straight away.
You know what? I've been on twice with you, Roger, and you've lost.
Is that right?
Yeah.
You're the bad old.
Right. It's not lost tonight, by the way. Let me tell you that.
I'm moving him again.
Nah, no secret tonight. Ryan Jack or Scott Wright scored in the cup final. What? That's us level. Roger Hanna's minus one is whipped out. The St Johnstone, the only team without a win, so we're still level. You both got it. Then it goes downhill a wee bit, Johnny, or quite a bit downhill. Forest Green was Duncan Ferguson's club. Roger goes one up. The second round of the Scottish Cup, Roger goes two up. Alex Ray's managed
the second round. I don't know.
I'll give you. I didn't think you did, but to be honest, it's not going to matter. Oh, you did. I'm very sorry. So you both got that.
I know.
Well, listen, just it gets worse, Johnny, because Dundee and St Mirren are Alex Ray's clubs that he's managed. Pat Nevin was the Accidental Footballer, and Falkirk have indeed scored the most goals.
We're going
in
for the 10.
SPFL. Oh, yeah, that's right. You did.
We're going for the 10.
You got them all right, Roger. Which German city will host the Euro 2024 final?
Oh goodness, Munich.
Berlin.
That's 50-50.
1, 2, 3, 4. He's got
that Bayern, you know, the Allianz Arena.
He got them all right anyway, Johnny. It wasn't enough hard lines.
Cheers, Johnny.
Yes.
Good man. Thank you, Johnny. Right, very quickly. We usually do this at the start of the show,
yeah,
but it was like so busy, so frantic. What was your result of the weekend?
Well, some people won't have noticed this, but Aberdeen won.
So they did.
Because and weekends like this, all the focus, and it's inevitable, Gordon, all the focus falls on Rangers and another disastrous result, and it's cost Michael Bailey's job. But for Aberdeen, it was a momentous win. First time in, was it 27 years or something, he'd scored three goals at Ibrox.
Result for you, Kenny? I know you would have gone Aberdeen. You were a big fan of that result of the weekend.
I think we'll go for the returning man to Scottish football. Big dunk up at Inverness. Absolutely. 3-0 up. Listen, he made it a wee bit tough. Dick Campbell's team come back and almost got them to a draw, but yeah, we held on for the win.
Goal of the weekend?
Not a great weekend, I didn't think, for stunning goals. I'm going to go for the lad Dara Costello at St Johnstone. His first ever senior goal on loan from Burnley. Good finish against Livingston.
Kenny?
And I feel like we need to give Motherwell something over the last 3 weeks. They've had performances against St Mirren and lost, performance against Rangers and lost, and a performance like on Saturday, which is incredible. So I'm going to go with Blair Spittle. It was a good goal, a good 1-2, a good sidestep. And I thought when the ball was just maybe stuck under his feet, it was a wonderful slide into the bottom
corner.
Can
you get an extra trophy for the best three-game performance and to result in no points? Is that a thing? No, can we look into that? Howler of the weekend.
Always like to include something from the game I'm at for Super Scoreboard. I was down at Rugby Park for Kelly and St Mirren. Poor Kyle McGuinness. If you're going to have a couple of minutes, he scored an own goal. He then gave the ball away in his own half and sprinting to try and retrieve his error. He did his hamstring and speaking to Derek McInnes after the game, it looks as if, unfortunately, the lad's going to have another spell on the sidelines.
And that is obviously a shame, but let's be honest, the own goal was enough. It was a bullet. It was a bullet finish.
Yeah.
Not one of those like, oh, he's really unlucky there.
Well, his manager said he
smashed it into the back of the net.
Bodies and he couldn't get his feet right.
I don't know what he was trying, to be honest. It was like it was the attacker going in and sliding and really getting that strong finish. But anyway,
who was your howler?
I'm going for the penalty on Liam Gordon, Joel Newbley, and Graham Granger again.
Referee.
For me, quite soft.
Okay. And top man of the weekend, top performer.
Individually, I think probably Graham Shinney, led by example for Aberdeen at Ibrox. And they've now got a wee chance. Helsinki at home on Thursday, St Johnstone at home on Sunday. And they could suddenly build up from what was a poor start to the season.
I'll go for the man that's top scorer in the league at the moment and scored that 97th minute winner for Celtic. I thought he's had a really, really good start to the season. But he could have had a couple of more goals as well this season. But what a wonderful start he's had to the season. And he was the decider, the match winner on Saturday.
You're both wrong. It's Bob McIntyre, actually. I'll have you know, this weekend. Top man, top performer.
Right, okay.
But anyway, this weekend only. 0141 951 1025. He's way too far away. Although Oban's quite far as well. John is a bit closer. He's in Maryhill. What's your main sort of overriding emotion as a Rangers fan tonight, John?
Hey, Dave. How you doing, Gordon?
Yeah, good, thanks.
Good. First thing, caller. I was just trying to obviously express my opinion about when Michael Beale came in, like myself and every other Rangers fan, we were all excited because we were getting told he was the brains behind the whole Gerrard factor. But he's brought in these guys. I mean, now he's went and signed 9 new players. And to us, he's, the way I feel, like, we've let go 2 good players, Ellis and Kent, and we've brought in 8 players to try and replace them, in my eyes. And they're just not cutting it. And if they're not cutting it for Michael Beale, who else are they going to cut it for? Is there any manager out there that's going to come in and make us a better team? Because to me, right now, we'll be lucky to finish 5th, 4th at the most, the way it's looking.
I always wonder about that stuff because it's just that's not the case, is it? You know, even a bad Rangers. I mean, St Mirren will have something to say about it. They finish above 5th, for goodness sake.
Oh, I think so. I think Def will finish above 5th.
What about John's point generally, though? Is that the difficulty? Because we need to be careful not to rewrite it. Getting rid of Morelos and Kent wasn't necessarily a mistake.
No.
But you need to make sure the guys that replace them are better.
And by the way, they might have not had a choice in the matter either. Because the players might want to leave.
Yeah. So it did sound like Michael Beale wasn't keen on the idea.
I think the writing was on the wall with both of them, to be fair, for a long time. But anyway, I absolutely agree with John. It struggles to see. This is where when you talked at the top of the show, fans want to see improvement from the signings. They want to see improvements in the performance. They want to see style. They want to see identity. At this moment in time, I don't see where that progress can come from that. I think the only time it comes back is when Lawrence, Cantwell, Raskin, Roof, and even Danilo, I know he's one of the new signings and he's not hit the ground running, but I've not seen a lot of him. We've not seen a lot of him to really make that judgment on that he's not going to be good enough. But until these guys come back fit, I don't know how you can see a better level. Listen, can the players be better? Yes, they can. Can they make better decisions? Yes, they can. But over the start of the season, we're 14 games in. Rangers played 14 games this season already. And we're still talking about like finding their feet and gelling and seeing improvements in performance. I just don't see, as each week goes past, that the likes of a Dessers or a Lammers or... Listen, Seymour's top scorer now at the club, you know, but there's still a lot of question marks over him. So it's, I think you only see improvement, I think, and the new manager will need to get those players back fit and get them in that starting lineup.
It'd be fascinating to see, though, if Stephen Davis and Alec Ray get a better tune out of these players in these two games this week, even if these are the only two games that this coaching staff takes the Rangers first team for. If there's an appointment during international break, I'll be fascinated to see if there's a change in style. Kenny was talking about identity. If there's a change in formation, if there's a change in tempo, and you know, if Stephen Davis and Alec Ray can get a tune out Dessers, Lammers, Seymour, these guys, more than Michael Beale did.
What do you make of the interim appointments, John?
To be honest, when I seen it this morning, Stephen Davis being appointed interim manager along with Alec Ray and obviously the other backroom staff, I was more excited seeing that than I was to see the Michael Beale appointment. Don't get me wrong, like every Rangers fan myself, I was really excited when I seen Michael Beale was going to be appointed the Rangers manager after he left the QPR job. But when you look at the signings that he's made, and honestly, I just kind of think that any manager that comes into this job is going to make us any better. To be honest with you, that's just my opinion.
Yeah, that was Kenny. What's it like in a dressing room? Because I guess there will be times when a manager loses his job, and the players, how to put it, not necessarily want him to lose his job, but like, maybe some of them feel that he's holding them back. But I've no idea if that was the case with Michael Beale. I know new signings are going to be complimentary. Did Dujon Sterling not call him a genius a few weeks ago or whenever he signed? I just wonder what impact it will have on them. Some of them maybe are really short and confident. I mean, let's be honest, Cyril Dessers must know fine well what the Rangers fans think of him, even if he doesn't bother to listen to us. They told him in person on Saturday.
Yeah, I also think he's been a victim of one of the main victims, actually, the current mood that's surrounding Ibrox at the moment, because it is every single... He actually looks, not scared, but he looks really tentative to actually put himself out there to receive passes, to take chances. And the 3 minutes in, when that chance falls to him, that was just a player that's lacking any kind of belief in his own ability to go and finish. You know, the finish was all wrong. So he's been one of the ones that has really got it tough in his early Rangers career. So it's just natural that there'll be some guys, not maybe necessarily not happy, but might look, I might get more opportunities if another manager comes in. And there'll be other guys that are really, really disappointed. And if the truth be told, they should also feel, I think the majority of the guys, that they have kind of let their manager down, because irrespective of whether you like them or you don't like them, your job's to go and perform, and you're playing at this, you're playing at a brilliant club, and you're giving all the benefits of representing that club, and you need to give something back. And at this moment in time, the performances have just not showed that.
Forgive me, John, did you give us a name for who you thought would be a good shout? I can't remember.
For the actual Rangers?
Yeah, yeah.
For the Rangers manager, so to be honest with you, Gordon, honestly, you'd be better off just putting names into a hat and just pulling one out, because
I think John's line's breaking up. I mean, that would be entertaining for everyone not connected to Rangers. I think that is okay, you know. Sometimes there is. You get to the stage, you go, I don't know what the best option is.
Yeah, and the board might take their time to assess the options. The last two occasions, there's been an obvious candidate. Michael Beale made sure he was the obvious candidate the last time for reasons we've discussed earlier in the show. I think when Steven Gerrard left to go to Aston Villa, Giovanni Van Bronckhorst, from moment one, was the obvious candidate. So neither of them really worked out to the satisfaction of the Rangers board or the fans. So maybe it's not a bad thing there is no obvious candidate this time. And there may be a greater degree of due diligence done on a greater number of candidates, and that might yield a better candidate this time, Gordon.
Every single time a managerial vacancy comes up, people say, in a very specific tone, need to get this one right. And it's always true, but like it does, you would just, you keep wheeling it out every time for good reason. What do you make of the interim setup, Kenny?
Listen, I think it's inexperienced, but I think when you look at people that are in the building at this moment in time, Stephen's an obvious guy to actually put right at the forefront of it. Someone who's been at the club, represented them a number of times over a number of years and had real success as a player as well. And he's probably, he's still, I think he's still rehabbing there out off the back of his injury. So I think he's an obvious one, but very, very limited experience in terms of coaching and things. So I think Stephen Smith, he's in with either under-16s, under-18s. He has been in back in the club for a number of years. Again, another ex-player, Alex Ray, represented the club a number of years ago. He's got the most coaching experience, I would say, in relation to first-team football. Mm. So, listen, I'll tell you this. They might take their time, Roger. The results in the next couple of games might allow them a little bit more time. If things don't go well over the next two, then there'll be a greater urgency to actually get someone in the building who is going to be there permanently, not just overseeing a few games.
I'm not saying it's right or wrong. Clubs can do what they like, but is that, you know, when you get an emergency situation like this, you know, some clubs have got somebody that does jump out at you. Like, I don't know, say the same thing happened at Celtic. I don't know, even John Kennedy went with Brendan Rodgers. You know, Steve McManus or Darren O'Dea would do it, you know, and it'd be kind of, it would be a sort of obvious one. I think David McCallum had to step in the last time just before Gio came in.
Graham Murty's done it. I feel like there's just no,
because of those experiences and because of the structure within Rangers at the moment, there is no obvious one. No. Is that why it falls on Stephen Davis?
I think it is. I think the thing that the board would have prioritised after Saturday's game is making managerial change. They would know that Michael Beale had run his race and had to go. They would deal with that and then think, right, who is around here that we can put in charge of the team? Stephen Davis was there. Some of the coaches behind them were there at a lower level. They brought in Alec Ray to bring a bit of experience. Listen, it's emergency situations for the Rangers board. They will hope, as Kenny says, that Stephen and Alec can get a couple of decent results this week. And that buys the board a little bit more time to assess a very big pool of potential candidates and then prioritise who they want to bring in on a permanent basis.
Give us a name, Stephen, in Knightswood.
We're not going to show.
Okay. And the one thing that might hold that back, because you're not just got a job. Just got a job, Stephen, at Marseille. You're going to be able to tempt him away so quickly?
Aye.
And a word.
Fair enough.
It's Rangers, isn't it? It's Gattuso.
I think he would have came right into the reckoning, because I think a lot of the characteristics he displayed as a player, and I think even as a manager, he's displayed a willingness to fight and show passion, and he's got experience. He is a winner. I think he's got the type of personality to stand up in front, being a Rangers manager. I just don't think, it's last week he's went in at Marseille, like it's just a week too late or 10 days too late or whatever it's been. I don't think you'd be able to prize him away after a week or two.
Anyone else, Stephen, your number one man?
That boy said Brentford. The Brentford manager.
Thomas Frank.
By the way, I'd like to see Stephen's Christmas list.
By the way, two great choices, by the way. Absolutely. But again, unfortunately, flying high in the Premier League, I can't see Rangers tempting Thomas Frank away for Brentford.
You're not asking for much, Stephen.
No, no. Just a mannequin.
You could have went for Klopp, to be fair.
Honestly, exactly. Why stop there? Let's pep up to, you'll be getting fed up.
Pardon, sorry. Can I speak? Sorry. I heard somebody say Neil Warnock to the end of the season. That is a shout.
I like that. I'm telling you, for this show alone, I like it.
I tell you what, I think I get it. I get the thought behind it, but it's short term. You know, if you're looking at planning, and again, you're looking at planning and moving the club forward, like what a career he's had over a number of years as a manager in England, but it's just short term. I don't think a short term appointment really.
What was the story?
Listen, I would say it's outrageous.
A house in Dunoon or something.
Yeah,
there's
it's a fair commute, that though, no?
There's a bit. Anyway, thank you, Stephen, the most ambitious man we've had on all night. I don't mind that. Always encourage you to dream big. It was Stephen giving us some names. Who would your preferred candidates be? Good time to share them. We'll get you on next.
Taking your call.
calls on Scottish football. 0141 951 1025. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Kenny Miller and Roger Hanna are here. I think it's reached that time of the night. And by the way, by the sounds of it, we could be doing this for weeks if Rangers take their time. But I think we should start throwing some names in the mix. It's so early that no shout's a bad shout. Sort of, within reason. We've had some lively ones already. So Rangers fans, or anyone else who's interested, get your thoughts over to us. Let me quickly give you this teaser.
The full-time teaser with Sliding Wardrobe Solutions East Kilbride. Tackle your customers' spaces with made-to-measure wardrobes.
Right, not going to dwell on this too long because I want to squeeze as many calls in as possible tonight. Since the English Premier League began in 92, 8 players have played for either Rangers or Celtic, and they've got 10 plus goals in an English Premier League season and 10 plus goals in a Scottish top flight season. Doesn't include loanees, by the way. So 10 plus goals in an English Premier League season and 10 plus goals in a Scottish top flight season since 92. Can you name them? Any that spring to mind?
Rod Wallace.
Yes. Leeds and Rangers. Kenny.
Did Robbie Keane get 10? No.
No.
Nikita Jelovic.
Nope.
Naismith.
No.
Oh my goodness.
Come on, these guys are, they're all goal getters. They're actually all big names. There's not even really anyone here.
Right.
I think. No.
Vicario.
Yes. Celtic, Sheffield Wednesday, West Ham. Any more quickly, Roger, and we'll move on.
Chris Sutton.
Yes. Okay. We'll get back to that. Let's squeeze in more names. Stephen is a Rangers fan. Give me a name, Stephen. Who would you like to see take over?
How we doing, panel? How we doing tonight?
Good, thanks. Good. You?
Yeah, I'm happy Michael Beale's finally gets P45 eventually. No, first of all, I think this is a bit left field, but I'd say Stephen Robinson. I think the job he's done at St Mirren on a shoestring is remarkable. He's done good at Motherwell, he's done good at St Mirren, and he's got the best out of players like, you know, Mark O'Hara, Ryan Strain, Scotty Tanza. I think he'd be a great shout for us right now, and dare I say, I don't think his compensation would be that much either. I know my fellow Rangers fans would probably want a bigger name, but I think it'd be quite a tactical appointment, and you'll want to see what the panel's thoughts on that one.
Listen, he's done a terrific job. Gordon will probably tell you he'll remember better than me. He did a decent job at Motherwell as well. A couple of cup finals, wasn't in that season, top six finish. Took St Mirren to their highest finish in almost 40 years last season. He kicked on, second in the league. I saw them at Kilmarnock on Saturday, and they now host Rangers at Paisley on Sunday lunchtime. That will be a big game for Stephen Robinson anyway. But I would think if Stephen Robinson, St Mirren, could beat the Rangers, I think a few more people might start linking his name with the job. And you have to remember, St Mirren Park, or the Smyzer Stadium, last season was where it all ended for Giovanni van Bronckhorst.
No, it's going to be Celtic. And I think that's massive right now. I really do think that's massive.
Is there... And to be fair, Stephen has seen it coming and said, I know my fellow Rangers fans would want a bigger name. Is there a case to say that because the standards are, or that's the wrong phrase, the expectation levels and the pressures are so different within our league, because we've got, you know, the two giants, that there is the days of actually hiring someone from lower down the league for those two clubs is gone. I wonder how tough it would be for some fans to take. And I'm not saying it's right, but I just mean the perception of it.
Sorry, on you go, bud. No, I think you're right, but I think that kind of attitude has also creeped into recruitment, because I think there's so many players in the SPL this season we could have got instead of Dessers, Lammers, Danilo, etc. You know, Duke, Miorski, Kevin Nisbet, and that really frustrated me. I think we're trying to be too cute with recruitment, and we could have maybe looked a bit closer at home.
Yeah, but I think that is true as well. I wonder if it's different with a manager, or is it the same?
Listen, I think the same can apply, and I absolutely agree, Stephen, that these types of players, I mean, listen, not all of them, but I think definitely one or two of them would have been maybe, again, with hindsight, better options than players that have been signed, particularly guys like Lauren Shankland, who scored 28 goals last year. He's an international player. I think he could have been a good signing for Rangers.
Stephen Robinson, do it
Stephen
for you.
Stephen Robinson, again, I think Rangers, I think he's done a wonderful job. I think it was third place finish with Motherwell, the cup finals, what he's doing with St Mirren at this moment in time. And I agree with Roger. I think Rangers have a real game on their hands on Sunday, when they visit Paisley. So he's done a wonderful job. Again, I do think that maybe Rangers fans will look for a bigger name, but has to be the right guy. That this is it. And if the board felt, you know what, let's look closer to home. I mean, I can't remember anybody doing it maybe since, what, McLeish maybe? Alex McLeish going for, for Hibs to Rangers. But by that worked out all right. You know, it was from a team that was lower in the league. So I think we do tend to just overlook our own kind of league now, again, for signings or managerial appointments. We do look further afield for the bigger name or the more glamorous appointment. Listen, again, I wouldn't rule out. I think it might be a big ask. I don't know if it will happen, but it's not absolutely out there. So Stephen's made it's not a bad suggestion.
Chuck some names, Roger, as many as you like that you think, I don't know, but who's in the frame? Do we know at all yet, or just throw some names out
there?
Well,
if you just look at the list of the bookmakers I've got, I'm never sure they're absolutely nailed on, you know, to get it right on day one of the hunt for a new manager, but the likes of Kevin Muscat at Yokohama, they've spoken about the likes of Ralf Hasenhüttl, Jesse Marsch, guys that have been in the English Premier League in recent times, Pascal Janssen, doing a very good job at AZ Alkmaar, Kjetil Knudsen, Bodo Glimt is another name that has been mentioned today. The likes of John Eustace, I think, was mentioned even last week down at Birmingham City, the job he's doing there. If you look closer at home, Stephen Robinson, who's just been mentioned there.
Noticed Marcello Gallardo tonight. Yeah. Seems to be one that I think is a story from not too close to here. It's not a Scottish-driven story, but that would be very interesting.
I think I heard earlier on, was it the former Monaco coach Philippe Clement was mentioned as well? You know,
I mean, that would be.
I wonder if former manager Stevie G would come into the reckoning. I know he's got a big heavy salary across in Saudi at the moment, but it was somebody that delivered the last title. He's definitely
bring Michael Beale back as his number two.
Well, listen, the mastermind. Stranger things would happen, you know. But he definitely carries the character and personality to lead. That's what I would say.
It's going to be interesting for sure. Thank you to Stephen. What about Ross in Edinburgh? You got any names, Ross? Any of those that we mentioned tickle your fancy, or someone different?
Well, hi, can you hear me, panel?
Yes.
Hi there. Yeah, I've got to throw a cat amongst the pigeons, and I'm going to say Steve Clark.
Wow. Discuss.
I can't see it happening for two reasons. Mainly because the job he's in just now, he's about to go to the Euros. You would imagine.
Win the Euros.
Recently signed a new contract to extend his stay as Scotland manager. So that would be the main one. I don't think he would be interested in the Rangers job just now, let's just say that.
With the whole bye-bye Rangers,
I don't think that helps. If it's been held against Michael Beale that he came and watched a Rangers game and went to a Rangers pub, then I think that would be held against Steve Clark, rightly or wrongly.
Agree.
And he needs to win the Euros first anyway.
And he's got a big job in his hands. Firstly, getting there, which is almost done, and then going and making sure the Scotland team could potentially be the most successful national team in history if they can go and qualify for the latter stages of a major tournament.
Tell us why you're for that idea, Ross.
I'm just thinking the best that's out there just now. Break the bank, pay him the money, and just get him on side, and he knows Scotland inside out. He knows the players. That's the best manager in my eyes to like take anything forward in Scotland. Is Kenny still there?
Yeah.
Kenny, do you remember playing for Musselburgh Grammar?
Of course I do.
Do you remember Big Ross Henderson that played up front with you?
Oh, there's a question. I don't know. I was a lone striker, as I know. I can't actually know.
Did you make him look good, Ross? He's got him to thank for his career. Your career.
Absolutely, aye.
Ross, did you do all his hard work? You flick it on, he would just chase pigeons.
No, I was catmate. I was like, he'd done all the running, eh?
Same as my partnership with Big Boy then.
Exactly. It sounds like. Thank you to Ross for throwing that name in. Profile of manager, right? Or these kind of brackets that we put them in. And Ross says, like, break the bank, get the best guy that's out there. I kind of get that logic. That reminds me a bit of when Celtic appointed Brendan Rodgers. And I always remember on this show and someone saying, like, do you know what? Go and get a manager and make him the highest paid guy in the club. You know what? Forget your star player or whatever. Go and get the manager to be the biggest and best out of everybody. And it kind of, that's what they did with Brendan Rodgers, right? And then obviously it worked. and I'm sorry to make the comparison, but it's just because Celtic have had the success recently. But then on the flip side of that, Ange Postecoglou was, Ange who, all that sort of stuff, but somebody who was clearly just identified as being a very, very good manager. And in case you hadn't noticed, he's now showing that elsewhere as well. So I'm always, I think even as a footballing public in Scotland, should we not have learned in the, over the last few years, that you can't come up with this profile, really, this one ideal.
So what we've actually had this on the show before. What do you do? What do you do? Do you don't, so you don't go for the big name and break the bank? So you look for the unknown quantity, because on both sides, there's no guarantee. And on both sides, you've got situations that have worked and situations that have no worked.
No, so I suppose, I mean, it's just always about it being the right guy.
Yeah, it does. Well, I think to have the right guy, if you have got a bit of evidence to suggest this guy's done a good job somewhere else, that suggests he's got it in him to actually then go and achieve some kind of success. Because if you've not, then there's nothing there to back it up.
Because where does it need to, you know, like, so let's say it's the big name, if you like, then, Roger, someone that's really well known, that we've really heard of. What, and try not to be disrespectful to Scottish football or Rangers here, they're going to need to be at a certain point in their career then. They're either going to need to be coming off the back of a failure, which might be held against them, or they might have to be someone that's on the rise, or, do you know what I mean? You're not getting, Colin mentioned it, Thomas Frank, I'm getting Thomas Frank at the moment, so... Well, if it is to be a so-called big name, what does that look like?
Well, that was how Celtic got Brendan Rodgers. He was out of work because he had left Liverpool. It needs to be... Circumstances need to smile upon you, Gordon. You need to find someone, as you say, who is willing to go off at a tangent in their career. You know, we just spoke there, Kjetil Knudsen, huge success at Bodo Glimt. But thus far in his career... hasn't really shown any inclination to leave Norway and try something else. And I think he's maybe 52 now. Pascal Janssen, again, really good success at Alkmaar in Holland, against the likes of Feyenoord and PSV and Ajax. But does he want to come and take on the challenge of facing down Celtic and Brendan Rodgers and that advantage they've got just now? And also, football runs on money, Gordon. You know, is there going to be enough there to bring in a new manager, to bring in a the backroom staff that he wants? And every manager wants to bring in footballers. Come January, there'll need to be a kitty made available for the next manager to buy players.
Because even in Rangers' recent history, obviously they went for Steven Gerrard, who had the profile and the name, but he didn't have the experience. And by all accounts, he brought up a coach who helped him along. Wonder whatever happened to that guy. So it feels like there's loads of different sort of categories, if you like, that these managers will fall into.
Well, and then when you fast forward, when Stephen leaves and Giovanni comes in, well, he has got good success and experience.
That was supposed to tick and a good big boxes, name, wasn't it?
I think Gio ticked pretty much most boxes. He even ticks the ex-player, you know, the connection to the club. So he ticked so many boxes. And at the start of last season, like, we're probably sitting in a very, very similar situation right now. A team that looked devoid of any kind of real plan, lacking in confidence, no great energy to the performance, and the results were suffering as well. So, like you say, it's tough. The board need to put the work in. They just need to go through it. They need to speak to however many people that they feel they need to speak to. They need to, again, if there's a proven track record there, and there is also a history, and it doesn't need to have been this big playing career, but if they're displaying the right type of characteristics of being this winning mentality that you look for, having the personality and character to stand in front of that Ibrox crowd. By the way, not when things are going great and everybody's singing your name, but when you're facing a little bit of adversity and you can still stay calm and you can still deliver and you can still hold yourself in a proper manner that a Rangers manager should. These are things that I think you can see, and you can negate a little bit of risk if you actually go and put the work in. And not just a point, again, like you say, the obvious candidates that have been there the last two times.
From Steve Clarke to Neil Warnock and Thomas Frank and Reno Gattuso, and this is only night one of the search. Strap yourselves in for more of this. Thank you for the previous call. We'll do more before the end. On your teaser quickly, you were looking for 8 players who've scored 10-plus goals in an English Premier League season and a Scottish top flight season since 92. So, De Canio, Sutton and Rod Wallace.
Hartson?
Yes.
Mark Viduka?
Yes, we'll get the rest of the answers next.
Just a guy guy clearly at his death that shouldn't have been there in the first place. Honestly, guys, if I could have got behind my couch on Saturday afternoon, I would have been still hiding there than now. They're a series of journeymen. The full club is a laughing joke now. There's no winner mentality anywhere in that side. Travelling here as well, poor board simply don't know how to appoint a manager. Can he not take some of the garbage he brung with him, away with him? When that stadium's in Sofia, it's a big shirt to wear. It's getting beyond a joke. And not one of the players will get the character to handle it.
Have your say. 0141 951 1025. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Yeah, just a flavour of what's been going on here on Clyde One Super Scoreboard in the last couple of days. It's been a busy old time for you Rangers fans, so keep the calls coming in very quickly on this teaser. Don't want to spend too much time on it. There are calls waiting, looking for eight players who've played for Rangers or Celtic who've got 10 plus goals in an English Premier League season and a Scottish top flight season. Di Canio, Sutton and Wallace. What else did you give me?
We've got Hartson and Viduka.
Uh-huh.
Tory Flo.
Oh yes, well done. Two to get.
Brian McClair.
No. Okay, two to get. We'll get them before the end.
Pierre Van Houten?
No. Let's go for Robert in Clydebank. Give me a name, Robert. Who would you like to see as the new Rangers manager?
Hello. Firstly, I feel sorry for Michael Beale. It seems like a nice man that should never have been given the job. That aside, let me say this to the Rangers fans. I urge you to be sensible, right? Just like when Sir Walter was appointed, when Alex McLeish was appointed, everyone was underwhelmed, right? Alex won a promotion with Hibs, out the blue, Rangers manager, competed with, I think it was Martin O'Neill, went on to win seven trophies in 5 years, right? We have a Scottish manager in Scotland with a pedigree of knowing our game inside out. Two promotions with two different teams, a League Cup, a Scottish Cup, loves Glasgow Rangers. Derek McInnes. Already this season, his team's beaten Celtic and Rangers. This chat with the Rangers fans, he knocked his back. People don't really know the real story, right? Sir Walter even said, you wouldn't have to look too far, regards Derek. Let's get a man in that loves the club, played for the club. Everyone else is a gamble for me, right? Muscat is a response to Ange. Is that where we're at, following Celtic? There's only one reason he's been mentioned. They talk about style of play. We aren't anywhere near that. We need to win. To the Rangers board, there's a saying, keep it simple, do it well. We need a good Scottish manager to become a great one. Give Derek McInnes a chance.
Yeah, listen, I wouldn't disagree with really anything that Robert said there. You're talking about things that work against Steve Clarke, you know, the things that have been said in the past. You wonder if Derek knocking the job back in 2017 would maybe work against him. I don't know, but listen, he's done a great body of work at Aberdeen over many seasons, 7 or 8 years. Great body of work at Kilmarnock so far, bringing the team up, keeping the team up. Victories against both halves of the Old Firm this season. So a definite live contender.
Yeah, in our game, if you're looking not too far from home, Derek McInnes definitely falls into the category alongside Stephen Robinson, guys that have actually done good jobs with multiple teams. I mean, like you say, when he was at Aberdeen for a number of years, there was seconds, there was thirds, there was European football, there's been the cup finals, there's been trophies. Stephen Robinson, again, kind of not quite done as much as that, but a wonderful job as well. So, and listen, we've talked about it before, Derek ticks the boxes of the Rangers connection. He's been a player through a wonderful era that brought a lot of success to the football club. So if you're looking, if they are, Rangers board are seriously going to consider someone close to home, then obviously Derek's name's going to be right at the top of that list.
Would you expect someone not from close to home?
I genuinely don't know. And this is nothing against the Rangers board. I don't think the Rangers board will know just now. I think they're sensible enough. This will be the first time that John Bennett and James Bisgrove together have targeted a new manager. Remember when Michael Beale came in last year, Douglas Park and Stuart Robertson were still at the helm. So it's all new. We don't know what path they will take. I think they'll take their time. I think they will exhibit due diligence on all of the candidates. And I honestly think it's a wide open field. We talked about Beal and Van Bronckhorst before him being the obvious guys. There is no obvious guy this time.
Do you need to know Scottish football? I'm not saying this was Robert's sole argument, and this is not meant to be a criticism of Derek McInnes, but sometimes you hear that this notion of, you know, a Scottish manager, someone that knows the game, does it matter? No. Ange Postecoglou, again, how many times?
I don't think it does. And listen, there's been managers over the years that have came in and had success that have not been Scottish or worked in Scottish football before. So I don't think it is. It needs to be one of the boxes that need to be ticked. It definitely helps. I think it helps more when there's a real, again, a crisis going on where you think it's a stable hand, is steady the ship, all these things come out. For me, I'm actually thinking, not in terms of any specific names, but I'm thinking that for big clubs now, they have these types of, these succession plans. Mm-hmm. You hear it all the time. So, right, okay, we're going to move Morelos on as a player, and we know who the next three or four guys that we're going to target. And it should be constantly changing because they guys might sign for someone. I think the same applies to be a manager. If you understand and you know, and this is where I think with football clubs, a lot of them fall down. I don't think they know what they want to be. You know, they don't know what they want. So this is going back to this style and this identity or how they want their club
sporting
to move forward
director
and play.
Debates maybe
that's
in there
where,
as well.
Correct. And that's where a sporting director can come into it. If you know what you want, I think it's easier, not easy, mm-hmm. but easier to identify potential targets. At this moment in time, I don't think Rangers know what we want to be. Yeah, we want to win, but that's an outcome. You know, but how are we going to get there? You know, that's what the Rangers board will be asking. And I think if you understand what you want, then I think it's easier to identify the types of traits or a smaller group that should be the next manager.
We're running out of time, so let me thank Robert and quickly bring in Peter. Give me the name, Peter. Go.
How are you doing, panel? The person I would love to see at Ibrox would be Billy Davis. The man's been out of the job for a long time, and he won't stand for any nonsense. Been at Ibrox, been an ex-Rangers man as well. Also, I'll take captaincy and bring somebody in, like Jack or somebody, maybe do the captaincy.
Right, I don't think we've got time for both of those debates, so let's go for manager first. Billy Davis is Peter's name.
Yeah, my understanding is he would be a contender as well. He's been out of the game for a long time, Billy, for various reasons. Great body of work down south, particularly likes of Derby County, Nottingham Forest, Preston, managing the English Premier League, great success in the English Championship. My understanding is he's very well qualified for the jobs, and he has seen an awful lot of football in the last few weeks and months, is looking to get back in and would be keen in this.
I could speak firsthand that he's top level, Billy Davis is. He's absolute top level. He took me down to Derby and it was a horrendous year for the club, but having that small amount of time working with him, his attention to detail, he's meticulous. Obsessed is it doesn't even apply here. He's very, very good manager and a very, very good coach. Loved working with him.
Would the time out of the game matter, do you think, to decision makers?
I think it would. I think when you've been out of the game a long time, mate, you're no long forgotten, you know. It's but is someone that if you get someone like Billy Davis in front of people, and there's loads of people I've came across in football, if he's in front of someone, I think he'll take people along with him and he'll convince them. So listen, whether he gets that opportunity or whether he was a serious contender, I don't know, but I just know from working with him, his passion, his energy and his knowledge is top level.
Right, I think we'll have to knock it in the head. It's an interesting suggestion for sure, Peter, but we've reached the end of the show already. But don't worry, we're on every night. That's the beauty of this show. Plenty more to come in the next days and weeks. So quickly, you two, looking for two more answers on the teaser. Eight players who've played for Rangers or Celtic who've got 10 plus goals in an English Premier League season and 10 plus goals in a Scottish top flight season since 92. Di Canio, Sutton, Wallace, Hearts and Viduka, Flo. One is not even a striker, not even an attacker really. It's a centre, kind of midfield player.
Oh.
Set pieces though.
Oh, PC, that's a good one.
I mean, if I give you the English club, it's like
nailed on.
Nailed on.
I'm toiling, Roger.
Blackpool.
Oh, Charlie Adam.
There we go.
How do we know that's poor?
Oh, this
that's
one's even really easier.
Poor. Is it?
What a goal getter this guy was.
What, Lovenkrantz?
Rangers, Celtic?
Rangers. West Ham, Tottenham, Sunderland, etc.
Defoe.
Etc.
Goodness me.
Anyway, we are back tomorrow for more of the same. I suspect the search is on for the new Rangers manager. And there are massive European games this week. It is not the week to be missing Clyde One Super Scoreboard, so make sure you join us at 6 o'clock tomorrow. Thanks for all your company this evening. It is much appreciated. And Callum Gallagher is up next.